So when I stayed away from Bharathanatyam, it was about 7 years that I barely touched it. I didn't learn anymore. I would still dabble every so often. And I think that was just the time when, personally, I was not struggling, but searching really for what my identity was. It's fresh out of high school, going to university. I was in university, not actually enjoying what I was studying. And I was still dancing. There was a time where I was in university and I was dancing full time and working two jobs full time, all at the same time. I wish I had that energy today, but those were things I was doing. I was really trying to figure out what I wanted to do, what I liked to do. And the thing is, coming from a mixed background, I realized that I was very well acquainted with my Indian side, very well acquainted with what the customs were, traditions, art forms. I don't speak any languages properly, but I can pick up here and there. I can get by in a conversation. I can recognize one language from another. But we never got that on the African side of my family. And that was different in the sense that the way people were brought to the West Indies was different. When Africans were brought, they were forced there. When Indians were brought, they were on contract. They were able to bring things from home with them. They were able to bring their instruments. They were able to some extent, in some places, retain their language. They were able to bring their religion and keep it. Whereas on the other side, that was all stripped from them. So I think that was a part of my life where I grew up mainly with my mom's side of the family, but none of us had ever explored kind of what that heritage was or meant. So I started delving more into doing things like Afro-Caribbean dance forms, hip-hop, things like that, just because it was there, but also in the wider community of Vancouver, very underrepresented. When I was doing dance hall, things like that, there's no scene for it in Vancouver. I actually became, I think at the time, the first and only dance hall teacher at the time. And the thing is, because somebody else who I had known was teaching a class, I didn't know personally at that time. And so my friend and I, she was from Trinidad. So we're like, dance hall class, what is that? We've been to the dance hall. We listened to dance hall since we were children. We know the dances. We're like, class. So we went to the class, danced, and the teacher came up to us after, because we'd never met before, and he's like, oh, you know this. I was like, I don't know what you mean by know it, but you know, we're both Caribbean. So he's like, keep coming to class. So I kept coming to class. Then he started putting me in his production. I run, I jump, I fly. Oh me, oh you, oh we, oh my. Your love, it takes me high. So real, so true. I can't lie.
Can't breathe when you come around me, me get weak in the knees. Boy, say, oh, please don't leave. I need you by my side and I'm begging you, oh, please.
In his dance groups, his crews, we used to go to rehearsals, we used to go to his performances, and that started taking over my life and I was enjoying it.
Me sing about straight jeans and white tees, them a sing about slippers. If me sing about head, them a sing about fitters.
And it was like, also the time that I saw you could make money off dancing, you could start making a living. There was a commercial industry for that. There was no commercial industry for Indian classical arts outside of weddings. So it switched my mind. It switched something as well, where I was like, oh, I love dancing. Dancing is what I've been doing since I was a child, but maybe there is a way to do something. And from then I had started teaching. I started teaching, I was performing full time, and that's all I was doing. Indian classical arts was still there, and again, that's when I had a very good friend who owned a performance company called South Asian Arts and Footage. And whenever she got a contract for something, she'd always call me. And she's like, I need a Bharathanatyam dancer. I need a male Bharathanatyam dancer. She'd always call me. And I would be like, I don't want to do this. And she's like, yeah, you don't have a choice. I'm forcing you. And I thank God to this day that she always was persistent in that I kept up with it. And I got some of my best gigs through her, like the Olympics, some music videos, things like that. Because she always was behind me, and she was like, she always said, I love what you do, I know you love what you do, but keep practicing Bharathanatyam, because that, and it still holds true today as it did 10 years ago, there's not many male dancers. And a male dancer will always, especially when it's like a group thing or whatever, they're always gonna need male dancers, they're gonna want male dancers. And she's like, if you love the art form, keep going with it. So I always kept practicing with it. And when I got back into it, I was happy that she always kind of forced me. So literally, she used to come to my house. And we'd sit there at the table with our laptops and papers. And she's like, so what's next for you? What are you going to do? And I was like, I thought you were coming just for dinner. She's like, no, we have to talk. It's a business meeting. Like, yeah, it was always like that. So. Yeah, I was drawn back to Indian classical dance when I had moved to Toronto. I had been there for a couple of years now. And I was working full-time, and I was doing dance hall and hip-hop full-time. And that's when I had got the call from one company that they were looking for a male dancer for two productions. They were doing two productions, and the productions were to go and travel abroad. And I got the call because the male dancer that they had called doesn't live in Toronto anymore, and we were good friends. He gave my name. So I went there and had 3 months of rehearsal, 7 days a week, for these two Bharathanatyam productions, and then a three-week tour abroad. When I had first went, and the choreographer, sir, saw me, and he asked me to dance Alaripu, I did the Alaripu, and he was like, you're out of practice. The first thing he said. Which motivated me to start practicing again. Then I had gone through the whole process of the rehearsals and the performances, the tour and everything. And by the end of it, of course, now being acquainted with the Bharathanatyam scene, because I did not know it at all in Toronto. I had not been part of it. I had not gone to any performances. Now being in the middle of it, just reignited it in me that it was something that now at this point I found was missing. So that put me on the quest to look for a teacher, which took about a year and a half of searching to find a teacher. And since then, I have been full-time. I've always worked full-time as well. Because again, I did move to the other side of the country, left my family in Vancouver. I came to Toronto, but I've been dancing full-time since then, taking Carnatic vocal lessons as well. All my really good friends are all musicians, dancers and musicians, but mostly musicians. So we're all together all the time, we're creating all the time. I learn so much from them just because they're all really good at what they do, be it mridangam, vocal, veena, violin, ghatam, whatever it is. They're all really good at what they do, and they all take they've also done, like the dancers are doing, they also come to India and take higher education as well. And their gurus come to Toronto as well, where they get a chance to do workshop with them, things like that. So we're always learning from each other. They're all learning how to play and sing and everything for dance. They're learning how to compose for dance. And so it's kind of come back full circle, where I just found, like, it was always part of me, and it's really fulfilling. I'm just happy to do it. I'd be at my job 8 hours a day, And I would leave my job, I'd travel 3 hours to get to wherever we were rehearsing. And I'd be there for 4 or 5 hours, and it doesn't even matter that I'm getting home after midnight to go 6 a.m. to work again and do the exact same thing the next day. As long as I was going then, I was with them and we're doing something, it was like...
My journey to Chennai started actually quite a long time before I ever landed in Chennai. I came across my guru, Sri Srijit Krishna of Sahirdaya Foundation, a few years before. He had been in Toronto actually, and he was conducting that engagement, well, at the same stretch as when mine was, and it was my first time actually seeing his choreography. I went directly to him and said, "Sir, I want to be your student when I come to Chennai," and he said, "Come." So 3 years later, I finally got to Chennai on a trip, and I messaged Srijit sir, and I said, "Sir, I'm only here for 2 weeks. I'd like to come see you." And again, he just opened his arms and said, "Come on this day," and invited me into the space to watch class, to sit and talk with him. And he said, "You know, when everything falls into place for you, just let me know that you're here." And within a few months, it fell into place for me. I got the chance to go, and I picked up and left everything in Canada, flew over to Chennai. I had gone thinking it would be mostly a solitary journey of me just waking up, dancing, going back to sleep. And I'm coming into a place where I don't know anybody. But I walked into the first classes, and the girls who I had seen previously during my trip, they saw me right away, recognized me, and said, "Hey, you're here." And that was it. We all became like siblings, basically. I had my classes in Bharathanatyam and allied arts. A lot of the times we were together at least 6 days a week. Besides Sir's body of work, his choreography, and his teaching methods, the things that really drew me to Sahirdaya was the way that the allied subjects were offered in such a holistic way. What I gained through my time is that the learning of the art is actually to make you just a better person and a better human being. We strive for perfection in what we do at all times, but at the end we learn how to appreciate beauty in everything around us, in sound, in sight, in scent, in fabric, in the movement of anything, not just dance-wise, the movement of anything you see around you in nature, in everyday life. And you realize that all these come from the learning of art, and it's really just there to make you become a better person, live a better life. And that's probably the biggest thing that I have taken back. I mean, I'm so blessed that I fell, everything fell into place at the right time, and I got a teacher like Srijit sir and all the other teachers at Sahirdaya, and of course my own teacher back home. I'm just really lucky to have all these people that are really working towards making better human beings and not just better performers or better dancers. And they really push you to go further and further and further every single time. Being in Chennai connected a lot of dots for me in terms of my practice. The things that we depict in the songs, in the poetry, I was seeing in everyday life. I was seeing simple things such as people on the roadside or in front of the temples stringing flowers. I actually got to see how they did it. At one point, Anjanaka had said, "Hey, what you need to do is today on your way home from class, you go sit down on the corner and you learn how to string the flowers with one of these people. And then when you come back and you do this varnam, you'll understand how to do it." So we got to see things like that. You could be anywhere and randomly a festival's happening, so they're pulling the chariot out around the temple. So I got to see these processions, you get to hear them. I got to go travel around a bit. I stayed in Sadhanam Kathakali Institution for a week. So being in Kerala and Patripala and learning Kathakali in the Kathakali school, in the Kalaris, and just living life with the boys in the hostel, attending the bhajans, having all our meals together, going down to the river and all with them, performing in their Kootambalam was one of the best experiences ever, just in terms of, you know, how humbling art can be. And then I got to do some other things, such as actually doing performances in Kerala and Trivandrum, in the Saturday annual day. I got to work with some great artists. It was season time as well, so to see eminent artists, young artists, people of all generations commingling all together, and just seeing so many different art styles, their performances, and just being moved by these, all these things like really came full circle. It's not something that I would have the opportunity to do in North America, especially in such a short amount of time. Being in Chennai really opened my eyes as well to how realistically portrayed all these things are done in our practice, and how that art really does imitate life and life really does imitate art.
Indian classical dance, I don't think it's helped me, not helped me, I don't know what it's done for my personal identity in terms of what I classify myself as, because I'm always having to answer that still. Everyone wants to know what I am. Are you Tamil? Are you Indian? Are you Malayali? Are you black? Are you, like, what are you? So that's always there. The answer is readily available. I obviously know what I am, but I was never searching for that answer myself, as into like, how Indian am I? What is my Indianness? Whatever. Like, it was never like that. It was just, I think what Indian classical dance has done for me has been to let me recognize that I love being a student. I think that's what it is. I don't think it's not really, I know people like to think about this or like to make it that way, but I don't really think it's about anymore. It's about ethnicity or cultural identity for me. I've seen it as a lifestyle for other people. I've seen how they dedicate their entire life to this. And I think for me, it's just that I'm happy of doing that with something. I think I'm glad that I found something. That's what it is. It could have been like, I could have been textiles or visual art or something like that. Like, it didn't have to be this, but I enjoyed it and I found it, and it keeps me going. And literally I wake up and the first thought, something dance related is in my head. I go to sleep, the last thing something dance related is in my head. It's not like, you know, I've never had to think too much about why do I do it, what does it define of me. See, the thing is, a lot of the times I get so lost in it, like when I'm like finally on stage, you get so lost in it that it takes a lot at the end to be like, what did I feel? How did I feel? Which for me, I think is a good thing, because if I'm not able to recollect all at once that exact feeling of, say, euphoria or whatever, that now, at that point, I knew that I was really experiencing it, and that's what matters most to me. I know when I'm here in class, especially here, because I get to be in class 8 hours a day, 6 days a week, you get to a point where you just know it's worth it. You know it's worth fighting through whatever pain you're having, like physical or not physical, knee pain, if there's any stress, whatever. You get to this place where you're doing something that just makes you forget all of that, and adrenaline is natural, and it comes and just lifts you up, and you're getting to portray something. I'm not a religious person, but all of the stories, the philosophical aspect of all of them are so beautiful. Something that really makes you want to be a better human being, live your life in a certain way. To get to portray that and really feel it, put it, imbibe it in your body and put it out towards people. I think that's really, it's a very gratifying experience. So I think that's how I feel mostly when I'm dancing. All these things are never running in my head at that time. But when you have to like sit and think about it, like, those are the things that you really.
Nagendra haraya, Trilochanaya, भस्मांगराकाय महेश्वराय नागेन्द्रहाराय त्रिलोचनाय भस्मांगराकाय महेश्वराय नित्याय शूताय दिगंबराय दस्मै नकाराय नमः शिवाय नित्याय शुद्धाय दिगंबराय दस्मै नकाराय नमः शिवाय.
There are definitely connections between, say, hip hop, Bharathanatyam, and things like that. Not direct connections, but yes, our body language will be different in both. But the thing that unites all dance is your core. You have to have a very strong core, and Bharathanatyam really helps you in identifying your core and how to hold it, how to keep it engaged. But the thing is, what I've taken from commercial dance, street dance, things like that, is how to talk about it. Because in Bharathanatyam, actually, when we're taught how to do things, say we're taught our adabas, korves, jatis, things like that, a lot of the times, especially when we were younger, we were not told actually how to engage our core, or even to, we're not told about our core. We're not told about where movement needs to originate from. If we're pulling something, where it needs to originate from, where your energy has to go. So those are things that I actually found that I was able to identify and vocalize from other styles of dance. And when you come and bring it back to Bharathanatyam, it's there. You see, it's there. It's just we didn't have terminology for it, maybe. We weren't able to recognize it. Other things, yeah, beat structure, rhythm, all that's there. It's funny, I'll listen to like some folk music, like Afro-Caribbean folk music or African folk music, something like that, and they'll be playing something, like Misha Chapu, right? But I don't know what they call it for that, or I don't know if there's a name for it, whatever, but now you realize you're able to count past 8, or other variations than 4 and 8. So you look at that, you learn it, and you realize that it's there in other art forms as well. You can sit there, you can listen to, I've seen actually, like traditional Chinese, ballet, I don't know the right word for it, but sometimes they'll be playing and you'll know what the beat structure is just because you've been here in Tala class for the last 13 years and you're like, oh, okay, I know how to do that. Where to from now? First of all, home. I've been here for 6 months, so I'm going home. I have no plans right now. I don't know what I'm gonna do. I don't know what the next step is, which I'm completely okay with. It's always good to have a reset, and I think this has been the best reset because I got to come here and just immerse myself, and I'm sure good things will come. I'd like, like everybody, to figure out a way to make this a sustainable full-time living, doing something I love. So I will go and I will look for opportunities or create opportunities.
for myself and other co-artists back home. Because I think there's a lot of us that really want to see the Canadian scene grow. And we'd like you said before, we'd like to actually get acquainted with the other scenes, whether it be Europe, Australia, India, other places. We'd like to get acquainted with them as well. But to do that, we have to be able to continue to put out quality work and things like that, so that opportunities to meet will come up. So I think that's going to be on my agenda. And another thing that I really want to do, because I've always said this, that in order for us to have a sustainable future, we have to basically, you have to train people to appreciate art. So I've always said that we need to somehow get our presence in the school systems. They have to see and hear classical Indian art, to know what it is, to appreciate it, to know what good art is, so that in the future they want to go. They want to go and see it. They want to fill the audience, the auditorium. They want to send themselves or their kids to learn it. Without that, then, I mean, what's going to happen for any of us? I don't know. I definitely enjoyed my 6 months here. It's almost over now. It's the longest I've been in India. The most time I've ever spent in India was 2 weeks. So what I took from it is just that you see that you can come from a place like Canada, North America, wherever, and you can leave all of those like conveniences behind, and you can be completely happy doing what you love and living simply and enjoying all of that and be fully gratified. I have no complaints about waking up at 6 a.m. and going to class and dancing 8 hours a day through 40 degree heat, and coming home, bathing with a bucket and doing it again the next day. You know, yeah. You'd be sitting in Canada thinking, I could never do that, oh my God. No AC, no shower, no hot water, you know, no TV, no internet, things like that. But I think if you found something that you love and you're doing it and you're applying yourself and you're with people who are guiding you, who have that same mentality, that have it dedicated their entire livelihood to just fostering good art and good human beings, that you can do anything. So it's been good. And if I can do it, anybody can do it.
Shalom, boy, hai, ras, mandi. Tadara, Tony, Udana, Din, Tananari.